Well, I think we have everyone here, and it's 12 o'clock by my watch. So I think we're going to go ahead and start. So welcome to everybody. Just going to look down here at our list. We have so far we have 34 folks that have joined us, participants, and that's another 10 presenters. We had a total of 99, which is our maximum number. So we maxed out with the registrants. Not sure if everyone will be able to actually join us or not. We'll see as we go along. So welcome to the United Church of Canada's webinar on poverty and housing in Canada. My name is Jordan Sullivan. I'm the Ministry Partnership Animator in the Church and Mission. Supporting the state of poverty in Canada. With me today are my colleague Sharon Buttrey, who's been helping oversee all the technological end of things. So a really big thank you to Sharon. Couldn't do this without her. And also with me is Christy Neufeldt, the staff person for Public Witness Advocacy and Campaigns, one of my colleagues in the Church and Mission Unit. The interest in today's webinar, I think, clearly shows that the members of the United Church of Canada and Canadians in general are very committed to the work of poverty reduction, or what many of us would prefer to call poverty elimination. We have quite a varied group of participants today. We have people joining us from BC, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, Ontario, Nova Scotia, PEI, and New food bank. Association. And social housing staff. And we did have registered I'm not sure if they're able to join us or not, but we had a registered the mayor of the village of Cumberland in British Columbia, Mayor Leslie Baird. So welcome to all of you. So before we begin, I just want to very quickly go through the process. This for today's webinar. I will introduce the three representatives from our national partners, Canada Without Poverty, Citizens for Public Justice, and the Canadian Housing. And each of them will speak for about 5 minutes. When they've finished, I will introduce the five representatives from the United Church's Community and Social Justice Ministries, and two representatives from the United Church Women's Bread Not Stones Project. They will each speak for about 2 minutes. At any time, you can type in a question into the chat box. If you want to direct your question to a specific individual, specific speaker, please identify that at the time. And we will gather those as we go through the webinar and raise those questions at the end during the open discussion. So we have scheduled the webinar to end at 1 o'clock. It may go a little bit over time, but as is usual practice for the webinars, if you have to go, you are, of course, welcome to leave at any time. But if you want to stay on for a longer discussion, if that happens at the end, please feel free to. Please note that the webinar is being recorded, and all of those who registered for today will receive a link in by email so that you can have access to that recorded webinar in the future and share it as you'd like. Okay, so let's begin. I want to start by welcoming our partner representatives, Jeff, Michelle, and Darlene. Thank you so much for taking the time to meet with us today. Our first day is Jeff.
The National Association representing the
providers
in Canada nonprofit association. Departments, providers, and so forth. So I first sure, I will. I'll try. Trying to really project my voice here. I think it's the system here. Is this a bit louder? The microphone. So hopefully that helps a bit. Great. So the first point I wanted to make, especially about a webinar on poverty and housing, is that from a federal perspective, there are at least two distinct processes that are currently underway with respect to the federal government. There is a national housing strategy that is being developed, and there is a separate anti-poverty strategy that is also being developed. Strategies are being led by ministers. Minister Jean-Yves, and we understand from his officials that both of these strategies are, in fact, overlapping to a certain degree. In fact, the parliamentary committee that is looking currently at the anti-poverty strategy has set aside 25%, but they are these two distinct strategies that are developing. I'll focus more on the
national
housing.
There, Michelle. Yes, if you could turn on your web microphone.
Flow national
studies and a
started. Out there. Pieces and all of these different pieces intersect with one another. So while we're talking about the poverty strategy, and of course that's one of the ones I think that we clearly have in sight, it's just important to keep in mind that there's these other processes happening as well that different ministries might want to be involved in whatever respect. So a little bit of background on Canada Without Poverty. For those of you who aren't familiar with our organization, we've been around since, actually our inception was in 1971. We used to go by the name the National Anti-Poverty Organization, or NAPO. One of the things that's really interesting about Canada Without Poverty is that since our inception, we've been governed by a board of directors, people with lived experience of poverty. So whether in childhood or as adults, there's real genuine experience that really guides our work and governs the decisions that we make as an organization. The second piece that I think is really interesting about Canada Without Poverty is that we're governed by a human rights framework, which means that we consider poverty very much as a violation of our international human rights obligations. And from that framework, we look at poverty through a lens of governments needing to further adhere to their human rights obligations and ensure that that when considering poverty, they're thinking about individuals as rights bearers rather than people that you're doing policy for. You're thinking of working on policy related to poverty as something to recognize and realize their international human rights obligations. A couple of pieces about the poverty strategy and what's going on right now. Some of this isn't very concrete. And the reality is, I think that there's a number of us non-government organizations out there who are kind of scraping together lots of different pockets of information. There have been some guiding pieces that have been released by Minister Duclos' office that we're certainly following. Very closely, and give a little bit of context, but you know, in terms of a larger strategy, those pieces haven't quite been put together, and we don't really have a concrete idea of that just yet. But what I'm going to do would give a bit. Of context to what we do know. So the one piece is that, as Jeff mentioned, there was just a human committee study done on Parliament Hill. That's an ongoing process. The HUMA committee is studying the poverty reduction strategy. They're going to write a report to Minister Duclos with their recommendations. Canada Without Poverty did make a submission to the HUMA committee, both in person and a written submission as well, back in November. Our position is mostly within this context of the poverty strategy needs to have a human rights framework. Human rights framework guarantees certain things within the poverty reduction strategy, including accountability mechanisms, very importantly, a consultation process with people with lived experience of poverty, targets and timelines, as Jeff mentioned, many different pieces. HUMA committee study is still receiving written submissions, if I'm not mistaken. Darlene can correct me if I'm wrong on that. So that might be actually an interesting way for the ministries to get involved. Some of you might have also heard about this Tackling Poverty initiative. That's a piece that's happening within six communities across the country. And within that process, they're going into these communities and they're studying local processes to address poverty reduction more on a regional level. We know that there's some sort of assessment going on that. From what I've heard through my channels is that there's a consultation company who got a contract to review what that process will be, a consultation company from Vancouver, and they are reviewing what those processes are and making some sort of recommendations. So more information on that, I imagine, coming from the government. There have also been a few private roundtables that NGOs have been invited to be able to advise
Thank you very much,
Mr.
Michelle.
Duclos on what we want to see in a Canadian
Darlene,
poverty reduction strategy.
If you could turn your
and there have also been a couple
on.
Of meetings. I think
Darlene O'Leary is the socioeconomic policy analyst with Citizens for Public Justice. Her work involves monitoring federal policy in relation to poverty in Canada, as well as research, analysis, and writing on poverty eradication. She works with colleagues and partners on Dignity for All, a campaign to end poverty in Canada, which involves public education and outreach, as well as meetings with public officials. She also develops educational, faith-based, and advocacy resources to support the work of poverty eradication. Darlene has worked in the areas of refugee resettlement and international development, as well as in an academic setting as a researcher, writer, and professor in the field of theology and ethics. She has a PhD in theology from St. Paul University in Ottawa, served as executive director of the Galilee Center in Empire, Ontario, where she managed a program including a spiritual and social justice program. Darlene was a postdoctoral fellow with the University of Prince Edward Island Faculty of Education, which involved research on Inuit educational leadership guided by the inspiring women who have taken part in the university's Master of Education Nunavik program. Welcome, Darlene, and we look forward to hearing from you about Citizens for Public Justice.
Hello, Jordan and everyone. Can you hear me okay? Should I be adjusting my mic or am I loud and clear?
You are
we good?
Go.
So important that and share our ideas. through public some of you know that organization. We are a faith-based organization. We're based in Ottawa. And we do social policy work in three main areas. One is poverty eradication in Canada. The other is ecological justice, and then also refugee rights. Among other things, but those are three primary areas of work, and we focus on federal policy. And a big part of our work is engaging faith communities and churches. On issues of federal policy. That are important to all of us. We have a faith-based foundation for what we're doing, of course, as to many of you. With United Church Ministry, for the the conversation. I'll just build on what Michelle was sharing with us about the human study and some of what's happening right now around the Canadian Poverty Reduction Strategy and the consultations that are going to be coming up. Some of you know, but maybe I'll just give you a little background. Citizens for Public Justice and Canada Without Poverty, both co-lead that's 2009, fully funded. And so since 2009, our organizations have built a nationwide network of supporters for our campaign and for our goals. And we worked very hard to gather support for the development of a comprehensive National Anti-Poverty Plan that
you need another minute, and that
has very solid policy foundations and it's fully funded. So the campaign throughout that process since 2009, we've actually worked to develop a model National Anti-Poverty Plan. So
okay, thanks to Jeff, Michelle, and Armin for that very informative
colleagues and organizations working on poverty. Canada,
obviously, we still have a lot to learn about where we're going from here and what here the actual shape of the consultation
for all
look,
our national
that gives us a lot of background
plan,
and
which is on the Dignity for All
direction on what
like
we need to focus on as we move
and
forward.
And what it provides.
So I want to now introduce you to some of the United Church Ministry folks that are here with us today. We have five people representing United Church's community and social justice ministries, and two folks who are representing the United Church Women's Bread Not Stones project. The church has about 65 to 70 community and social justice ministries, which are community-based organizations across Canada. They range from large urban organizations to smaller urban or rural ministries. And there are also many more United Church congregationally based outreach programs. Bread Not Stones is a resource available on the United Church website. It is also a United Church project to raise awareness and advocate with all levels of government to eradicate child poverty in Canada. The initiative has been adopted by the group United Church Women as their national project, and you can learn more at inchildpoverty.ca. I will introduce these seven United Church representatives in order of their speaking from and they will each their hopes. Your questions a specific person you want the question to be directed to. Lisa. Is the CEO of Stella's Circle. Which is a leading community organization in St. John's, Newfoundland, with staff. The mission of the organization is to transform lives through real homes, real help, and real work. Range of services and experienced Dean Stella Circle received the Canada Volunteer Award for Social Innovation, as well as the Better Business Award. Member of the United Social Justice Ministry Reference Group, and
thank you. I hope you can hear me. Let me know if you can't. Great. Okay, I just want to mention, first of all, that poverty reduction, not elimination, is very much the news. These days. Whether it's local, municipal, provincial, and national. Let me just outline what's happening municipally. Toronto continues to have the highest level of poverty amongst
Can you hear me? Can you hear me, Jordan? I'm sitting back a little bit. First of all, hello, everyone. I do have Laurel in the room with me, and we have another very special guest. This is Dolly, and Dolly is our symbolic doll of hope for London and Middlesex. and we wanted her to be here with us. I'd also like to mention that Bread Not Stones is supported by the UCW, Mission and Service, and hundreds of dedicated people across the country. Since our job is to advocate with government to end child poverty in Canada, we're thrilled to be here today. I'm not sure if you're aware that currently there are 1,302,000 children living in poverty in our country, and this figure includes 60%
Thank you very much, Lisa.
Of First Nations children living on
Okay, next speaker is Tina Conlon. Tina, if you could unmute your microphone. Tina was unexpectedly unable to be in the office today, so she's joining us from a location where she doesn't have a webcam, but there's your beautiful photo, so we can look at that as she speaks to us. Tina is community minister at Davenport Coast Community Ministry in Toronto, which is a ministry of presence, walking in solidarity with the culturally diverse low-income ministry of our community of Davenport Coast in Toronto. The role of the ministry is to provide community development and community organizing organizational support, offering pastoral care, and to be engaged in advocacy through coalitions and networks. Tina has been active in the fight against poverty, hunger, and homelessness, both locally and abroad, and was one of the first members of the Toronto Food Policy Council, where she served on the board for 7 years. She also served on the Social Poverty Action Group. Tina received her Master of Divinity in 1983. And has since worked in a number of nonprofit organizations. Tina, tell us what your hopes and needs are for this.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. 2 minutes doesn't begin to cover the amount of time that it could take, but anyway, I'll do the best. I think the National Housing Strategy, the paid discussion paper that's out there, really covers the basics, helping those who need it the most, housing for Indigenous people, making housing more affordable, ending homelessness, strengthening social housing sector. There's no secrets. Anybody in housing, by the way, I'm going to be focusing primarily on housing in these few words because that's where I've spent most of my time. So my hope is that this consultation process is not just a process. I've been, you can see by my face and hair that I've been kicking around for over 45 years in politics and advocacy. So I've seen many hopeful signs come and go. My big concern is, where is the money? Where are we going to get the money? We can have all the best ideas, good plans, indicators, marks, etc. But changing this system is not going to be easy. And it's not going to come without some significant changes to the overall economic system. And our previous speaker pointed out how the rich are doing very well in our system and the poor are getting poorer and more in number. I forgot to start my stopwatch to tell me. So, Jordan, please cut me off. So what we need to do.
Thank you, Clark. I know we're going to be pushing folks a little bit more because we are going to go over time. So I'm going to ask the next three speakers to try to keep it as succinct as possible. I think probably the part that people are most interested in is going to be the discussion and the asking of questions. So hopefully a good portion of you can stay till after 1 o'clock when we get into the discussion. If you can't,
social housing needs to be done
Bonnie graduated from the University of Regina with a Bachelor of Human Justice and Justice Studies at the University. She served on including the Navi issues, the chair of because that's a great description of Bonnie. And she's been economic, social, and cultural in 2006. Also a member of the United Church's Community and Social Justice Ministry.
Sit on the court challenges program Canada without poverty. Sorry about that. Caught on this 2 minute thing. Anyway, what are my hopes for the public consultation? That we see more involvement of people living in poverty. So that they can actually have an input. I mean, these politicians making decisions need to hear how their decisions are actually impacting people living in poverty and how their decisions have created and sustained poverty. Yes, we do plan on participating in the consultations. And our organization, what is it we want from the federal government? Well, I think Michelle talked about some of this. We would like to see the federal government to start seriously addressing
darn it. Hello, hello. coming through? Is it okay? Sorry about that. Thanks for the introduction. Jordan, basically, the Longhouse Ministry in almost every year ministry I've been a part of over the years. Four plus decades now is gets caught up in that charity and justice tension. I mean, ideally, I hope it's a tension, a creative one, so that I recognize through the ministry that charity seldom moves to justice unless it's intentional. And by justice, I mean everything from a redistribution of power to the organizing for such so that it can occur. I mean, people write about it, and I read about it all the time. Sometimes I long for perspectives on social justice that gives a meaningful ideal and to aim towards, and a way to kind of, if possible,
our next speaker is Sharon
responses to poverty
from Calgary, Alberta. Sharon is a retired classroom teacher.
Thing. So that's why the Longhouse, as small as it is, we're very small. Just a half-time staff
child well-being,
there's 1,000 people that go through the place in the week.
As a grassroots movement of women in the United Church concerned about the increasing level of child poverty in Alberta.
Ranging from,
she's been the co-chair of the
sharing circles to
2009.
12-step meetings.
Currently, they're focusing on affordable, accessible, safe,
networks like the community where that at least can
spare
time for significant issues. We tried to
give
that last night, in fact, to the whole understanding of evil. Evil in the sense of when one being starves, thwarts, or reduces another being in its activities, to use a description from H. Richard Niebuhr.
Okay,
also, we've had
Sharon
to be intentionally involved over and above our work, over and above just being at the Longhouse Church on a daily
Sharon, could I ask you to project your voice and speak a little louder?
Yeah, I'll just note for people that the Dignity for All campaign will be kind of revitalizing our website and offering more resources specifically for folks to engage in the consultations for the Canadian Poverty Reduction Strategy. So I encourage people to join, check out our website, check out our individual websites, Canada Without Poverty and Citizens for Public Justice, but also Dignity for All, which is where we will have the model plan. But we'll shortly,
I thank you very much. Our last speaker is Barry Morris. Barry, if you turn on
talking points or webpages or ways to engage,
Barry, you have to turn on your
meetings with
webcam.
So those are the sort of things that we want to be able to
provide. Barry is from Vancouver. Was born in Vancouver. He's currently a ministry with the Lighthouse Council on Native Ministry, Associated Network of Streams of Justice, Metro Vancouver Alliance, the Community Aware, and Kairos all combined to assist his work. Barry's prior work experience includes work with First United in Vancouver, St. Matthews, Maryland Community in Winnipeg, and Toronto's Christian Resource Center. He's also had experience in urban ministry in Chicago and San Jose. I'm going to cut short some of your introduction there, Barry, and I'll just let you speak for a few minutes here before we get into our final discussion. Thank you.
MPs really need to hear
all yours, Barry.
That social affordable housing needs to be a priority.
There we go. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, and I just, from a national perspective, the sense here at the that the wisdom in terms of input for national anti-poverty strategy and housing strategy lies with the community and social justice ministries. You have the lived on the ground experience, and it's from that place that we really would hope that the input into the consultations online, in person, that be the United Church voice, however those consultations happen. So we're speaking, I guess, a bit Jordan and I's behalf, interested to know how we can help facilitate that. We know that you'll probably be doing that on your own behalf, but are there ways that we can post your what you will be sharing online on the United Church website? Or are there ways that we can help share among
All right. Okay, can you hear me? Yeah? Okay. All right, so just to kind of add on, and thank you, Jordan, for starting off the conversation with that question, because it's something that Darlene and I are contemplating right now. Not only how do we guide the consultation process from a rights-based place, from a place where people's lived experience of poverty are very much involved in the consultation, but what do people on the ground, ministries from the faith-based community as well as from human rights community, frontline community, how can we as national organizations best coordinate those processes? So and of course we do have a couple of ideas going around with Dignity for All, but just to kind of encourage everyone to please feel free to contact Darlene or myself about ideas, whether it's something as simple as Dignity for All, hosting the submissions everyone makes to the HUMA committee, putting up information about what consultations are taking place when we have that information available. And as well, Darlene, I think, alluded to this at one point in her presentation, but on October 17th for the International Day for the Eradication of Poverty, we have this huge pain that she wants on this. Campaign where we have people mobilize and take to the street, and thousands of postcards last year arrived at Minister Duclos' office calling for a poverty strategy. So we also have this public engagement piece, which I imagine coming up to October is going to be very big. So just to kind of continue the dialogue with us, because we want
Mary. Yep. Okay. Thank you very much. Good timing. Okay, I'm told by Sharon that the questions that folks have posed throughout the webinar, speakers and others have been providing the answers in the chat box. So I will ask now if there are any new questions that haven't yet been asked that you would like to raise. Please type those into the chat box, addressing your questions, if you have, to any specific person. And just to let you know, we will be sending a list of all the resources shared today, whether they were shared in the chat box with specific links to resources, or whether they were organizations or other interesting resources that were mentioned by speakers. We'll send an email with a list of all those resources and where you can access them online. In the near future, hopefully in the next week, along with the link to the recorded webinar. So, questions. Are there any questions of our United Church Ministries that you would like to ask of our partners? I know that we will need to continue to work together on how we can engage in the public consultations as it unrolls, how that's going to happen exactly. So we'll be in touch by email to do that work. I'm getting a note from Christy here. Michelle asked the ministries and participants, what can national organization do to coordinate ministries' participation in the national consultation process? That's definite. That's the question. What can we do? we have a network of community ministries across the country, including the United Church Women, that I think that a collective voice and a collective presence would be very helpful. Michelle or Darlene, you're welcome, or Jeff, to pop in at any point, put your webcam on if you want to respond to any of these issues, or if you have suggestions on what we might do.